Neil, I'd like to know how you got the Beatles out and fooled everybody last night.
Well, it was so hard to get them in that I decided with the chief of police and with the police captain that when they came off stage, went straight off stage, turn right into a lift and go down to the basement. When we got there, we went through sort of subterranean passages, through boiler houses, etc. And then through where all the newspapers and people had been for the convention, right the way through to an underground passage with just one-way traffic going through it. And from there we got into a police van and went the wrong way out of the passage. The police had blocked it off, you see, so we could go through the wrong way down this one-way street, across a parking lot, and then down Pacific Avenue to the hotel.
I asked this of Derek before. Is this one of the worst experiences you've seen? You've been with the Beatles from the start.
No, we can never judge what is a worse experience than another. They're all the same. They're all very tricky, or a lot of them can be, you know, but none of them, I don't think any of them are worse than others.
Was this one of the most ingenious ways that you have had to figure out to get them away from some hall or some location?
No.
What is one of the most ingenious ways that you have done it?
Oh, there's been so many that I just can't think of one that's much more ingenious than others. A lot in England, we've gone from the actual theatre underground and come out in other buildings and up lifts. Oh, you know, we've gone a couple of blocks underground before we've actually come out into the cars or the van or whatever we go out in, you know.
Have you ever disguised them?
No, never disguised them.
Neil, you've had many experiences. Was there ever one time when you just were at a loss for a plan, when you just didn't know what to do?
No. I can never be at a loss for a plan, or we'd still be in the theater now.
Thank you very much, Neil.
Okay.
We were in the second limousine. I say we, I mean the American road manager, the New York press officer, who was a young woman, me, the GAC man, a very tough, energetic young man called Ed Leffler, and in the car in front, as usual, were the four Beatles and their road manager, Neil Aspinall, who knows more about getting in and out of hotels and theatres than anybody alive, having been with the Beatles since the very beginning. Now, their car drew up outside the convention hall and was immediately surrounded by kids. How it happened, I don't know, because everybody had been warned that Beatle crowds were unpredictable and wild and dangerous. Am I speaking too quietly for you?
No.
Neil, as usual, guided the driver to what to do, whether to move on a bit or to stop still. Still, the police bashed their way through. I've never seen movement like it. They just had to crash through to protect the crowds from themselves. One man at least, who as far as I could see had been climbing across the bonnet, had his leg either broken or very badly bruised, and it really was an indescribable sight. And then the police managed to clear a way for the Beatles at least to open the door and look like getting out. The door then closed again because it became unsafe, and Leffler ordered everybody out of our car to go and help. Unfortunately, this meant that Bess was to stay behind, but of course the kids got into the car and got at Bess, and she had to get out as well. So there we all were, separated from the Beatles by the crowd, and ourselves in danger of being battered by the police, who, I'm not blaming the police, because they did have an incredibly difficult job to do, and they had to protect the lives of the Beatles, which were endangered.
Was this one of the worst experiences you've ever seen with the Beatles?
Yes, it's one of many tricky situations. In all cases, of course, the police are blamed for being rough, but had they not been rough last night, and I mean, this means being rough with me as well, because we're unidentifiable figures. Everybody knows the Beatles, but nobody knows us. It was pretty bad, and it was due to the unpredictability of a Beatle crowd.
Wouldn't you say, Derek, that the police departments who are in cities where we're going to arrive soon could make some preparations, though, and get prepared for this? Don't you think a lot of them don't realize how badly it is?
I think that's true. They've all seen crowds before. I mean, this city, Atlantic City, has seen conventions and seen a great many things. The very nature of the city and the size of the convention hall suggests that it's a center for big crowds. But what they've never seen is a Beatle crowd. And they all say, we know our own people, we know the police potential, and we're going to be able to handle it. But this is the biggest thing that's ever happened. There's no question about it. It's like nothing before. It's not like Presley, it's not like Sinatra, it's not like the late President Kennedy. It's the Beatles, and they are without precedent. In New Zealand, for instance, where you have a small, orderly, Presbyterian community, the police said very often two or three men would do outside a hotel. What happened was that a crowd of about 5,000 would arrive all of a sudden. And all the time, there are four Beatles to protect, not one, but four. And four Beatles, not only to protect, but to be attacked.
The Beatles have a day off today and tomorrow. Could you give us a rundown on what they did today?
They slept throughout the day until mid-afternoon, and then they got up, had breakfast, simple breakfast as usual, and then did a little bit of shopping. Shopping by hotel, that is, they call stuff in rather than go out since they can't go out. And mainly watched television, read, wandered about, and I suppose relaxed in their way.
They'd sort of been fancying this color TV. Had they ever seen it before, before they came to this hotel?
No, they hadn't. None of us had. I don't know quite what we expected. I think we expected the perfection of Technicolor, which is not in fact what we got.
They've done quite a bit of swimming, haven't they?
Oh, they have, yes. Not by day, because they can't get the pool at day, but they swim at night. As soon as they can get in, they do. This humidity here is getting us all a bit, you know. We're not used to heat like this.
Does Ringo swim?
Ringo swims. He's not an Olympic, up to Olympic standard, but he swims, you know. He moves his arms, he moves his legs, and he stays afloat. But he usually goes from side to side rather than from end to end, which is much the same as me.
Derek, you're about as close to the Beatles as anyone all the time. They have to stay in the hotels most of the time. I know I heard a comment by one of them. A person said to them, it's so hard to get to see you. And the Beatle answered back, this was Paul McCartney, it's so hard to get to see you. Does this plague them all the time, the fact that they can't get out and meet the public as well as friends in various cities?
It doesn't really plague them too much now. They've come to terms with that, the same as they've come to terms with everything else, with their money and their success. What does plague them sometimes is that people expect them to go out and say that everything will be all right. You know, I mean, when you've got an organized thing like an entry into a hotel and you nearly get slaughtered, how on earth can you possibly go on chance to a nightclub? A boy said to me in the lift today, a 17-year-old boy, I'd like you to know that a group of my friends are disgusted at the Beatles not coming downstairs into the lobby and showing themselves. When do they meet people? Well, the answer is that they can't meet them that way. What they do do is, if they can, they see... We sift through the fans, and we have a lot of fans up in twos for a handshake and an autograph. We do our absolute best to meet the demands, but everybody in the world who's compos mentis and some of those who are not wants to meet the Beatles.
Now we have George Harrison. George, we've been hearing rumors and reading things about a woman who has been predicting a plane disaster. What do you think about these things? What are your personal thoughts about them?
Well, normally I think I'd just take it all, you know, with a pinch of salt. And
Wait a minute, sorry.
I'm
just starting to ask you. Start again. All right, go ahead.
Normally I'd just take it with a laugh and a smile and a pinch of salt and think, you know, she's off her head. But, you know, it's not a very nice thing to say, is it? Especially when we're flying almost every day. But, you know, just hope for the best, keep a stiff upper head, and away we go. You know, if you crash, you crash, don't you? When your number's up, that's it.
Are you going to go on the plane?
Oh, no, I'm going on a bicycle on that particular day. I'm not superstitious, but I am going on my bike for that trip.
And George, I asked you this before. In relationship to the American press, so many of them come to you in so many cities. How do you feel about this? Does it ever get to you?
Yeah, we always see the press every place we go, and we always read the papers the next day. And usually the majority of papers, I'd say about 95 out of 100, usually good. But the odd five, you know, we do get, they dig at us, you know, but it's... You know, we accept it because it's usually written by a gang of narcs anyway. Crummy people who don't like us from the beginning, and they, you know, regardless of what we say and do, you know, they've got it in for us anyway. But it doesn't worry us.
The other day you mentioned to me that you'd rather, we asked you if you wanted to live in America, and you said that you'd, you know, like to spend your entire life as a permanent resident of Great Britain. When you come over here, do you see a basic change in philosophy, a change in the people, or is it generally the same mood of atmosphere and feeling over in England? Is there a difference in this country? We both speak the same language. How do you feel about this? Is it different to you?
Yeah, it's different, you know, in as much as people talk different, drive on the other side and have hamburgers and all that, but basically I think it's the same. Oh, the people who run this country, you know, it's a bit different, I'd say, to the Parliament of Great Britain. But, you know, as far as I'm concerned, it's not all that different, except that, you know, it seems to be more happening over here, more things that I like lots of TV, radios, drive-ins and all that sort of stuff. But I do like Britain because, well, the main reason, it's a great place, and I was born there anyway, and you can't, you know, move just like that. I think I wouldn't mind living here for a few months each year, but not permanently.
One more question. I notice you're wearing a lot of, in your spare hours, a lot of what we call dungarees, Levi's or Western wear. Do you dig this American Western type of dress, or have you always been wearing these?
I've always worn jeans, you know, because it's good when you feel like being scruffy, you can just lie around the floor in them and do anything, but you can't, you know, even if it's an old suit, you still feel a bit funny, but in jeans you feel perfectly relaxed, but I do.
George, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Win a harmonica like the Beatles play.
Not a toy, but a genuine Hohner Marine Band harmonica, just like those played by the Beatles.
KLIF is awarding 50 of these fabulous Beatle harmonicas.
To be eligible to win, tell KLIF on a postcard in 25 words or less why you like the Beatles.
Send your entry to Beatle Harmonica, KLIF Dallas.
50 winners in all.
Decision of the judges is final.
Deadline for entries, midnight, Saturday, August the 29th.
Play along with the Beatles with your own genuine Hohner Marine Band harmonica from KLIF. Yeah.